Good day to all of you listeners, viewers. We have another one of our sessions here. With me today is Mark Gresham from PSI-PCI. We get together every now and again on a kind of a more informal basis to chat about the issues that we see that Mark really picks up in the industry when he's out training and helping people figure out what went wrong. And we've identified a couple of things so far. The first was about cylinders and the amount of energy in cylinders and the disrespect that the average diver has for the poor, humble scuba cylinder. And then when the scuba cylinder gets filled at the filling station, we had a discussion about some of the hazards associated with that. So the third part of the picture is the valve that fits in the top of the cylinder. Now, I don't know how astute you are, you know, paying attention to the social media, but we had a report again, I think it was last year in Europe, where the instructor was in the pool training his students and the cylinder valve came off the cylinder, hit him in the back of the head, and it was a fatality. And Mark, when he teaches his courses, are very, very particular about cylinder valves and the threads that meet or match between the valve and the cylinder. It keeps happening. And you know, the codes and standards have tried. They've put in all sorts of new requirements. If you look at a new scuba cylinder, it's meant to have a little code that you won't understand what it means, but it says U12, that we know that's a pin index valve with a CGA top fitting for for an oxygen resus cylinder. Mm-hmm. But nonetheless, the industry is trying to get to a point where the cylinder has a marking, a stamping on the neck of the cylinder, and the valve has a matching stamping on it. Mm-hmm. But that's not what happens. And Mark, tell me, you know, you'd think if you were trying to mate two threads that are different, you would think it's impossible to do, right? But
it's not impossible to do, because in our industry, due to lack of knowledge and lack of experience in some cases, people take a valve, any valve, and put it in their cylinder. Well, a couple of things we need to worry about. Is it the right valve for the pressure rating of the cylinder? Is it the right threads? As you said, a metric valve can be installed in a NPSM, National Pipe Straight Mechanical, which is common in the United States, and screwed in, and it'll go down about 3 or 4 turns and it binds up. So what does the average diver do? We use great big wrenches, because after all, you're not much of a diver unless you own several large crescent wrenches. And you turn the thing down and you turn it the rest of the way down, and the threads are not exactly mated as designed. And numerous cross-threaded valves have been ejected from cylinders, some causing fatalities. It is very preventable. A valve that is straight threads or parallel threads with an O-ring seal can be installed to where it mates using your hands. There's no other tools required until, after it's installed all the way to the top face of the cylinder, we apply the requisite torque. It is not complicated to do, but a lot of people just don't understand. You never need to force a valve unless it is a tapered thread valve, and that's a whole separate issue.
You know, most people selling scuba cylinders will sell it with a valve installed.
Correct. Okay,
so one wouldn't expect this to be an issue, and one would not really expect the scuba cylinder suppliers, manufacturers, to be at fault. But we know scuba divers see somebody has a valve, or they want to manifold two cylinders together, and they get a really great valve from this company, and they get a scuba cylinder, they don't realize it's a metric or an imperial one, and everything seems to fit. The wrench does the rest of the work. So I think in general, a dive shop that owns their own cylinders is not going to have this issue. Yeah. The trouble that I've certainly seen is when the dive shop accepts personal cylinders to be filled,
right,
they should be doing something. They're the ones that should be aware of this, and they should be looking at the cylinder valve, at least from the model, know what it was made for, it's metric or imperial, and then make sure that the cylinder is designed to match that. But as you said, in some cases when you try to install it, it's actually, sometimes it's really loose, and then they over tighten it to get it tight. And then other times it just doesn't screw in. And then we get tapered thread, and people do all sorts of interesting things with those too. But I think really the codes and standards have tried, and I say they have tried because here in the US we still see things that don't comply with the standards. So CGA, Compressed Gas Association, in the United States, and it influences many countries around the world, has been pretty specific. So just as a takeaway, on the cylinder should be a code. It might be a letter like U12 or something else, either within the number that's on the cylinder or maybe up towards where the neck is, and the cylinder valve should have a stamp too.
Sure.
And if nothing else, if you know both of them got stamps, you're kind of on the right track. But the person filling a cylinder, and heaven forbid, people that own their own Cobresas, mm-hmm. even greater sense of responsibility to mm-hmm. make sure that you know what the differences are. Mm-hmm. They look very similar. Mm-hmm. In fact, if I showed to you here on mm-hmm. on the camera two that we know are not correct, you wouldn't see the difference, would you?
No.
You'd need a gauge to determine that.
I would say the alert diver, Dan, has done an excellent job with articles comparing the two. At first glance, mm-hmm. they look identical. But the big key here is a parallel thread. You should use your hands. You shouldn't have to force it in any capacity. At PSI, we produce a little Delrin plastic thread checker, and it'll tell you whether it is a metric valve or metric cylinder or an American standard thread. And incidentally, the code for the 3/4 inch NPSM for the United States is SP12. Now, the only company that's putting that on there right now is Catalina. The other companies are going to follow suit, as we've spent a bunch of time trying to get forward this subject, because it's an important subject. And every year we have valve extrusions. It's preventable. It is easily understood. It's a very short period of training to understand the whys and wherefores of how this works.
So the kind of the takeaway is check before you fill. Right. And if you're not sure,
right.
Don't fill.
Okay. Always err on the side of caution, no matter what. And it's a prudent practice, and it's a smart practice.
So thank you, Mark. Hope you found that interesting. Again, please, if you have any questions, you can write to us at riskmitigation@dan.org, one word. And I normally drag Mark in to help me find some, you know, really practical answers to your questions. And we do, again, we take a lot of this information, put it into Alert Diver and various other publications to share it with you. And we're here for you. So please, if you have questions like this, you're concerned, then write to us and we'll do our best to answer it.
Absolutely.
So thank you.
Appreciate your time.